Hi dear students, today we start with chapter number 19 of kinesiology, that is walking aids. What is walking aid? Walking aid is a device designed to assist people walking and improve the mobility of the people who have difficulty in walking or people who cannot walk independently. Purpose of walking aids: increase area of the support or base of support, maintain center of gravity over the supported area, then they redistribute weight bearing area by decreasing force on the injured or inflamed part of the limb, can be compensated for weak muscles, decrease pain, improve balance and improve proprioception. There are number of aids available to assist people who have difficulty in walking or who cannot walk independently without one. These external aids are crutches, sticks and frames, braces and splints, which can be used to assist walking, are beyond the scope of this book, so we don't discuss here. Basically, there are three types of walking aids that we discuss in this lecture: crutches, sticks and frames. Brief history. 2830 BC, carvings at the tomb of the Herkov before 18th century, canes first made from cuttings of the tree branches, then crutch, single piece of the wood with the crossbar, 18th century, introduction of the different designs, then in 20th century, aluminium and steel tubes, plastic foam, rubber as accessories. Functions: they improve balance, give proprioception, decrease pain, reduce weight bearing on the injured or inflamed structures, compensate for weak muscles, and then scan the injured environment. Selection: stability of the patient, strength of the upper and lower limbs, coordination of the upper and lower limbs, required degree of the relief from the weight bearing. These are the factors that we consider while selecting walking aids. First, crutches. These are the devices which are used to reduce weight bearing on one or both legs and also give support where the balance is impaired and strength is inadequate. Prerequisite for crutches: good strength of the upper limb muscles is required, range of motion of the upper limb should be good, obviously good, then shoulder adductors must be strong, elbow and wrist extensors and finger flexors, these muscle groups must be enough to take the weight of the crutches. Type of crutches: three types: axillary crutches, underarm crutches, elbow crutches or lost hands crutches, and forearm crutches, you call it as gutter crutches. Now, axillary crutches, look at this diagram. They are made of the wood with an axillary pad, a handpiece and a rubber barrel. The position of the handpiece and total length are usually adjustable. The axillary pad should rest against the chest wall approximately 5 cm below the apex of the axilla, and the hand grip should be adjusted to allow the elbow to be slightly flexed when the weight is not being taken. Weight is transmitted down the arm to the handpiece. The elbow is extended. No count should weight be taken through the axillary pad, as this could lead to the neuropaxia of the radial nerve or brachial plexus. Measurement of the length: there is a variety of ways of measuring the patient for crutches. It is usually carried out with the patient in the lying position. We choose of measures from the apex of the axilla to the lower margin of the medial malleolus. This is an easy measurement and is reasonably reliable. We choose on 5 cm vertically down from the apex of the axilla to a point 20 cm later to the heel of the shoes. This tends to be less accurate than the first method. The measurement from the axillary pad to the hand grip should be taken with the elbow slightly flexed, approximately 15 degree from 0.5 cm below the backs of the axilla to the ulnar steroid process. Once the patient is standing with the support of the crutches, physiotherapist must use the correct way to use the crutches and to see that they don't allow the axillary pad to press into the axilla. These basically crutches, standard advantage, improve balance and later stability, provide functional ambulation with restricted weight bearing, easily adjustable, inexpensive, can be used for stair climbing easily. These are basically bolts that you can adjust for changing the length of crutches. What are the disadvantages of crutches? Awkward in small areas, may compromise safety and when choosing in crowded place, limited upper body movement, axillary crutches require good standing balance by the patient, tendency to lean forward on axillary bar, pressure on the radial group, potential damage to the vascular structure. Precautions: have someone nearby for assistance until accustomed to the crutches. You carefully check that all pairs are securely in the place. Check screws at least once per week. Clean out crutches tips to ensure they are free of dirt and stones. Remove small loose rugs from walking paths. And beware of ice, snow, wet or waxed floors. Avoid crowds. Never carry anything in hands. Use a backpack. These are basically precautions that the patient must adopt before using crutches. Second, forearm crutches. They are made of metal and have a metal or plastic forearm band. They are usually adjustable in length by means of press clip or metal button and have a rubber ferrule. These crutches are particularly suitable for patients with good balance and strong arms. Weight is transmitted in exactly the same way as for axillary crutches. Measurement of the length. The measurement is usually taken with the patient in the lying position with the shoes on. The elbow is slightly flexed, approximately 15 degree, and the measurement is taken from ulnar steroid process to a point 20 cm later to the heel of the shoes. If the patient is standing in the support, the length must be checked. What are the advantages of forearm crutches? Forearm cuff allows use of the hands, easily adjustable and allows functional stair climbing, most functional for patients with bilateral KFOs. And using forearm crutches requires no more energy, increased oxygen consumption or heart rate than axillary crutches. There is no risk of injury to the neovascular structures in the axillary region when using this type of crutches. Disadvantage: less lateral support, cuffs may be difficult to remove. They require good standing balance and upper body strength. Geriatric patients sometimes feel insecure with this type of crutches. Gutter crutches, adjustable arthritic crutches and forearm support crutches. They are made of the metal with a padded forearm support and strap, an adjustable hand piece and a rubber ferrule. They are used for patients with rheumatoid disease who require some form of the support but cannot take weight through the hands, wrists and elbows because of the deformity or pain. The crutch is adjustable in length in the same way as the elbow crutches. It should also be adjustable in the length of the forearm support and the angle of the handpiece to allow the deformities. Measurement of the length. Basically, if the patient is able to stand, it is better to assess the required length in this position from elbow to the floor. Measurement can be carried out with the patient lying with the shoes on and is taken from the point of the flexed elbow to 20 cm later to the heel. A patient with rheumatoid disease may allow the hips and knees to flex in the weight-bearing position because of the muscle weakness or pain, but with gutter crutches for sport, he may be able to obtain more extension. This must be taken into account in any adjustment. Advantage. Look at this picture showing gutter crutches. Advantage: Similar like elbow crutches, they are easily adjustable, more cosmetic than other crutches. Disadvantage: provide less lateral support due to absence of axillic pad. Cuff may be difficult to remove and this can be expensive and rarely used. Crutch walking. Preparation for crutch walking. Arms, power of extensor and adductors of the shoulder and then extensors of the elbow must be assessed and if necessary strengthened before the patient starts walking. The hand grip must also be tested to see that patient has sufficient power and mobility to grasp the handpiece. The result of this assessment will determine the type of the crutch chosen. Legs, non-bed bearing position. The mobility and strength of the unaffected leg should be assessed, paying particular attention to the hip abductors and extensors, knee extensors and plantar flexors of the ankle. These muscles must be sufficiently strong enough to take weight. The patient is taught hip hitching on the non-weight bearing side if it is required. So look at this at for upper extremity, power of extensors and adductors of the shoulder and extensors of elbow must be assessed and must be strengthened if necessary. Further, that we pay particular attention to the hip abductors, extensors, knee extensors and plantar flexors and ankle joint because these muscles have to take on weight. So beside these, patient is taught hip hinging on the non bed bearing side if it is required. Partial bed bearing. For partial bed bearing, mobility and strength of the both legs must be assessed and muscle strengthened where necessary. Sitting and standing balance must be tested and trained if necessary. The physiotherapist should demonstrate the appropriate crutch walking to the patient and see the important point. No, crutch walking. The physiotherapist should have an assistance when the patient is to stand and walk for the first time. This person may be another physiotherapist, a nurse, another healthcare worker, relative. The physiotherapist must instruct the patient, assistants or therapist, on how to support the patient to the upright position and then how to transfer the patient onto the crutches. For non-bed bearing, the patient should always stand with a triangular base, crutches either in front are behind the weight bearing leg. To walk, the patient first moves the crutches forward, takes weight down through the crutches and lifts the foot forward in a position just behind the line of the crutches. Once this is mastered, the patient may progress to lifting the foot forward, a position just in front of the line in the crutches. It is important in certain cases for the patient to rest to shadow walking where the affected leg is moved in sequence simulating walking but taking no weight. Partial weight bearing. There are two methods of partial weight bearing. Number one, this is a basically progression from shadow walking where no weight is taken to the affected leg to permit a gradual increase of weight to be taken. The crutches and affected leg are taken forward and put down together. Then the weight is taken to the crutches and affected leg and while the unaffected leg is brought through. This method, the B method. This method basically stimulates normal walking and more weight is taken to the affected leg. The right crutch is moved forward followed by left leg. Then the left crutch is moved forward followed by the right leg. This can be progressed to moving the right crutch with the left leg and vice versa. Two additional less commonly used crutch gait patterns are the swing to and swing through patterns. And these gait patterns are used when there is bilateral lower extremity movement such as in spinal cord injuries. Swing through gait, fastest gaits and require functional abdominal muscles. In the swing through gait, the crutches are moved forward together but the lower extremities are swing beyond the crutches. swing to gait. Both crutches, both lower limbs are moved to the crust level. The swing to gait involves forward movement of the both crutches and simultaneously, and the lower extremities swing to the crutches. These are the pattern of some daily activities like stair climbing. Remember that when in stair climbing activities, then up with good and down with bad, and follow this sequence to for sitting and standing with the help of crutches. Now we discuss tics and gains. Tics may be either of the wood or the metal with curved or straight handpiece. The metal ones are adjustable and therefore suitable for assessment purposes. The wooden ones are cut to the required length. Measurement. Basically, measurement can usually be taken with the patient in the standing position. Elbow is slightly flexed and measurement must be taken from the ulnar stylet to the floor approximately 15 cm from the heel. The patient may use two sticks in the same way as the method described for the partial weight bearing walking with crutches. Sticks allows more weight to be taken through the legs than do the crutches. One stick may be used on the unaffected side so that the stick and affected leg are placed forward together and taking some of the weight to the stick. These are the examples of tripod, quadrupod. Metal sticks with three or four prong bases gives a more stable support than a stick. Most common mobility aid, commonly made of the wood or aluminium, transmits 20-25% of the body weight and held in hand opposite to the involved side, compensate for muscle weakness, leaves pains, elbow at 30 degree flexion. Advantage: improve balance and posture stability, reduce biomechanical load on the lower extremity joints, widen space of support with less lateral shifting of center of mass, reduce forces on the hip while walking, and further they reduce knee pain in osteoarthritis patients restricted in non-weight bearing and partial weight bearing. Type of the canes and sticks. Look at the standard cane, tripods, standard adjustable aluminium cane, and these are the quadrupods. Gait pattern with cane. Start from here, move cane forward, then step forward with the opposite foot, bad foot, and then step forward with the good foot. Frames. The commonest type is the lightweight frame with 4 feet, which may be adjustable in height. The patient lifts the frame forward, then lean on it and take 2 steps. The patient should take even steps, keeping the frame well forward. A bag can be attached to the front of the frame to carry small items. Ataxic patients who are too unsteady to lift the frame forward may be able to use a rotator frame, which can be pushed, or a reciprocal frame where each side moves independently. Walking frames basically used to improve balance and anti-weight bearing, greater stability, provide wider base of support, improve anti and lateral stability, allows our extremity to transfer body weight to the floor. Typically made of the aluminium with molded vinyl hand grip and upper tips, adjustable adult size 32 to 37 inches. The physiotherapist must check the safety of all the walking aids, not only when giving them to a patient but regularly throughout a treatment aid. And the patient must be taught to inspect his walking aid and know where to obtain replacement parts. ferrules, which are made of the rubber elastic, should be rubbed to give a high coefficient of friction. The general structure, including screw, matter clips, press buttons, hand grips, and auxiliary pad, must all be in good position. Types: standard, reciprocal, and rotator. These are the standard walking frame. Basically, consists four almost vertical aluminium tubes joined on three sides by the upper and lower horizontal tubes. One side is left open. Hand grips on the upper horizontal tube, rubber tips at lower end of the vertical tube. Reciprocal walking frame, basically identical with the standard frame. Each side of the frame can be moved forward, and swivel joints between horizontal and vertical tubes. Advantage: allows unilateral forward progression, useful to the patients incapable of lifting the walker to move it forward. Relatively lightweight and easily adjustable. Disadvantage: less inherent stability, awkward in confined area, and eliminates arm swing. Cannot be used on stairs. Rollator: two small wheels at the front and two leg without wheels at back, or one wheel at each leg. No need for lifting the whole device. Care to be taken for elderly patients. Best suited for children. Thank you. Hopefully you all like this, my video lecture. If there is a question, you can ask me in comment section. Thank you again.